Hello, welcome to United Church of Hyde Park. It is so good to have you all with us. I have a word for you today, and that word is mindfulness. Can you say it with me? Mindfulness. Often on my phone, I will go through pictures and I will scroll back. And if any of you are in this similar situation, I have years and years of pictures. And when I look back, it makes me very mindful of how good God has been to me. In those pictures, I see God's grace and I see God's goodness. It is important for us in these times, and I'm sure you come to church perhaps for that reason, to be mindful. It's important on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday for us to be mindful of God's presence. We have to be mindful because sometimes we can forget and we can end up in some places. So I'm leaving this word with you at the beginning of our service this morning, being mindful of God's presence and God's goodness. Welcome to United. It is so good to have you with us. Welcome, welcome, welcome.
Thank you.
From the moment we open our eyes each morning until we close them at night, God is with us.
There is no one like you, our God.
In times when we are surrounded with struggles and in the mystery of life, we still find hope. Jesus is with us.
There is no one like you, our sibling.
When we feel isolated in this world, when we are welcomed into the community of faith, the Holy Spirit is with us.
There was no one like you, witnessing spirit.
From the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 13, verses 24 through 30. He put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to someone who sowed good seed in his field. But while everybody was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat, and then went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared as well. And the slaves of the householder came and said to him, "Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? Where then did these weeds come from?" He answered, "An enemy has done this." The slave said to him, "Then do you want us to go and gather them?" But he replied, "No, for in gathering the weeds, you would uproot the wheat along with them. Let both of them grow together until the harvest. And at harvest time, I will tell the reapers, 'Collect the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn. I'd like to use as a sermonic theme this morning, weeds and seeds together. Weeds and seeds together. Over a decade ago, a friend of mine that lives, has a getaway house up in Wisconsin, her family invited me to her home. It was a little bit of a drive, but with some good music, I was able to make my way through a couple of cities and a couple of rural areas and a couple of toll roads to finally get to a stretch of land where it turned from road to gravel to just hard packed land. After a narrow path of up and down and up and down, I finally arrived at her home with a beautiful pond, her house, animals, a barn, a couple of cows, and other animals in the yard. Any place in a rural area for a period of time works for me, and I suddenly felt myself relaxing and kind of vibing with just the space and the energy of country living. In the country, everybody works. Nobody gets a pass. And so after I had come into the home and sat for a while and talked, I was sent off to gather flowers for the evening dinner. So to go outside, walk up a ways back behind the house, and pull out a few flowers for a floral arrangement to sit on the table. I left the home and walked out and was amazed by this orchestra of just beautiful colored flowers of all kinds of colors. I picked a few of this color, I picked a few of that color, and after I had picked about five different colors, I felt rather pleased with myself. And I proceeded back to the house to hand the host the flowers I had picked it so she could arrange them in whatever way she saw fit. It was in that moment that she said, "Charlene, you've picked a lot of weed." I didn't know. I was from the urban area and weed looked a certain way. In the yard, it didn't look like weed, but I was informed by her that some of what I picked was weed and some of what I picked was flowers. But honestly, I was like, without her eyes, without her skill, who could tell the difference? What I was astounded with in that moment, and even as I reflect back upon that moment, is how beautiful the weeds and the seeds all look together. I was amazed and did not actually know that one was weed and one was flower. Today we enter the biblical text and we're talking about weed. It appears that a farmer had planted some good seed, and then another person comes along at night and plants weed. This is a story about seeds and weeds. The seed come into life wanted. The seed is intentionally planted. The seed has expectation that with the right tilling and tending and feeding and watering, the seed will produce wheat. These seeds have purpose. They have a goal. They have an aim. Seeds are good and productive, and they feed and they nourish and they sustain life. And yet this talk of weed carries a different tone. By the very fact that we refer to the seed as good, it implies something about the weed. The weed is like a bastard wheat, resembling wheat, but the grains are black. It resembles wheat, and that is why it is hard to detect until it is growing and intertwined. I stopped by this morning to talk about the weeds and the seeds. Years ago in my own garden, when my son was about 3 years old, I was pulling weed because I was fully buying into the stereotype about weeds. I was freeing the seeds in my garden to grow. My son wanting to help, because at that age, kids want to help you. Later, it's a different story, but at 3 years old, they want to help. They have total positive energy. And so he asked if he could help me pull the weed. Well, I could use all the help I could get pulling weeds. So I said, "Son, go for it." And so I went and continued to pull weed. And After a few minutes, I turned around in horror to find out that my son was not pulling weed, but he was pulling plant. I say all this to say that it's hard sometimes to discern the difference between a weed and a seed. Maybe the skillful gardener, but maybe many others of us have mistaken at points in times a difference between weed and seed. Here's the question that I want to lay at your foot today. If God made the seed, then who made the weed? If God made the seed, then who made the weed? We often say, and we just walked through Genesis a couple of months ago, that God's blueprint is on every living organism. So if God made the seed, then who made the weed? And if all things are made by God and everything that was made by God has purpose, then maybe the weed is getting a bad rap. In the text today, the weed has already been judged. The farmer assistant wants to do something about the weed. And it isn't loving, it isn't kind, it isn't merciful. The weed is perceived as a threat to the livelihood of the seed. Just this week, one of our members posted on social media this large, tall dandelion, one of the tallest I had ever seen. It looked like it was at least about 4 feet tall. It grabbed her attention, and so when she posted it, it grabbed my attention as well. And her focus was left and said that if this weed is left to its own devices, it will grow just like things in our life. Again, implying that somehow the weed has to be taken out. The weed cannot be left to its own devices. The weed cannot be allowed to go. If God made the seed, then who made the weed? You see, already in this text, we have ascribed a negative value to weed. We have labeled the plant as not worthy. We have gone as far as to say its intent is evil. And so intrinsic in the teaching that the worker comes to his boss and inquires, what are we gonna do about the weed? You wanna make this weed get out? Do you wanna end its life? Do you wanna send the military in? Do you wanna send the law enforcers in? What do you want me to do about this weed? Today, the text we are reading is a parable. Parables do not tell us everything. It takes something familiar to point to something sort of unfamiliar. Parables are open to some and to others, the door of understanding is closed, according to the writer of Matthew. It's almost like a special entrance door is given to some to perceive deeply what the text is saying. Some interpret this text to have two complex meanings, while others say it's more complicated than that. It's more complex than that. It's subversive. It's intended to subvert or disrupt the established system or institution. The farmer says to his worker, let the seed and the weed grow together. That's good news, just in case you didn't know it. The weed and the seed can grow together. Catch that out. What amazes me about weed is, if I can totally be honest, that without care, without love, without tending, without water, without cultivation, without any attention at all, the weed still grows. Maybe the weed can teach us something about thriving in adverse situations. Just maybe the weed has something to say about its making. But in our world, the weed has gotten a bad rep. You might leave here today and be bold and say, I'm a weed. I'd advise you not to call somebody else a weed unless they've listened to the sermon. But you might want to experiment a little and leave the church today and say, I think I might be a weed. I'm a little unruly. I'm a little unkempt. I grow wild at times. In our global world today, clearly there are seeds and there are weeds. If I told you to take out a piece of paper and write down what you thought a seed was and what you thought a weed was, probably we would overlap in some of our answers. You see, everybody wants to be a seed because the seed is a glorious position, but nobody wants to be a weed where one's existence is not wanted. We have a way of making some people feel in our country and in our world that they are unwanted. Listen to these phrases and tell me if you can hear the weeds speaking to you. Fat, four eyes, criminal, looters, urban, minority, poor, lazy, immigrant, Irish, Muslim, damaged goods, angry, thug, stupid, violent, bossy, those people, untouchables, make America great again. Homosexual, gay, two-parent family, lively, uncouth, loud, wow. These are our weeds. Lucilla Clifton, a poet, says, every day something has tried to kill me and has failed. Weeds don't die easily. They just keep coming back. But why are we trying to kill the weeds? Why do we treat certain people one way in our country and another group differently? Could it be we've been taught to see some people as weeds and to see other people as seeds? The real thing is, until someone pointed it out in my friend's backyard, I saw the beauty of both. I didn't distinguish between names and labels. They were beautiful on her table, but then one had to be called weeds, and one had to be called seeds. The text says today, let them grow together. Last year, I went to two conferences with total strangers, and I'm gonna ask Wei-Jin to put this picture up. One of them was at the Wild Goose Conference. This is like the conference, it's just interesting. Anyway, there were definitely some weeds at this conference, and there were definitely some seeds at this conference, if you get what I mean. And anyway, I'm not sure I knew all of what I was getting myself into, but this is an outdoor conference that takes place in Hot Springs, North Carolina. I'm feeling hotter now. But this takes place in Hot Springs, and actually, if we didn't have COVID last week, we would have been at the Wild Goose Festival. Anyway, you meet outdoors, and I had taken a tent. It had just rained for hours, because one of the things I didn't know was that high up in the mountains, it rains a lot. And so it rained for hours. There were mud puddles everywhere. And here we are on a little bit of ground that's not totally damp that we're trying to put our tent up on. And after about 15 minutes, we haven't made much progress. But then some strangers reach in to help us out. Let me say, at this conference, I knew almost absolutely nobody. I showed up with a bunch of weeds and strangers and seeds, and something amazing happened. That after spending about 4 or 5 days together, people stopped being strangers, and they stopped being seeds, and they stopped being weeds, and we came to know one another, and we came to tell jokes with one another, and we came to break bread to one another, and we came to share our stories with one another, and hug one another, and be kind to one another, and pray for one another. Something happened in that context, and I see it often happening when you put people together. After a while, the titles of weeds and seeds gets less and less. Strangers helping us, us helping strangers, folks giving each other the high five, folks eating together, folks sweating together. Much better than me sweating by myself up here today. And then towards the end, there was a sadness, because the weeds and the seeds became intertwined. And community was developed, much like here at United Church of Hyde Park and other places, when we allow ourselves to deviate away from the titles. And by the time it was time to leave, we were feeling sad, but we're feeling excited, because we're like, we'll see you next year. relationships have been formed, and even a couple of people I've kept in contact with on Facebook. And on the video today, you have a picture of what happens when seeds and weeds grow together. But who is the weed and who is the seed? Again, I've witnessed this over and over again. People put together who tear down walls instead of building them up. When we open ourselves up to others, this is what happens. When we peel back labels to get to know people and their stories and their journeys, and we see their humanity, this is what happened. Seeds and weeds getting along and building community together. Seeds and weeds together. Amen. It is giving time. Every week, I get up and I do this. I ask you to share your financial resources because we do this every week, or we do this every 2 weeks, or we do this every month. We continue to give, and we continue to support United, and we continue to support this vision, and we continue to support this faith community. So it's that time again. Share your financial resources, pour them out. You can give three ways. You can come by the church and drop off your money. You can mail it in, or you can give electronically, and that's on the screen. And I want to say thank you, United. Thank you for being so faithful. Thank you for continuing to give. This is your time to share your financial resources. Thank you. Let us pray. Dear Lord, you pour into us abundance of your love and your grace. You pour into the weeds and the seeds, and we pour out right now. We ask that you bless our community, that you bless our families, and that you bless our world, that you bless the ministries of healing and hope throughout our globe. In Jesus' name, amen. So today we have two new folks who want to become members. I have to tell you, there are things that all of us like about our job and things we don't like about our jobs. One of the things I love about being a pastor is when our community grows. When there are people that say, I want to be a part of United. And today we have two people who have made that decision. We have Alvin, who you see standing up before us. He came with a visitor over a year ago, and he's been coming every Sunday almost since then. And he just stayed and he stayed and he said, I like this church. I really like these people. And so he's been very faithful. He's been very committed. He's tried to help out, put his hands in, roll up his sleeves. He will be with us for open breakfast this Saturday, and is ready to make his commitment to United Church of Hyde Park official. Second, we have Blair, who is also making a decision. Blair is a pastor. She's a retired pastor, but she's still an ordained minister in the United Church of Christ. She is a strong advocate. She is outspoken, and she refuses to let her voice be silenced. Blair probably would say she's experienced some we treatment in her own life. And she just recently retired. She moved to the north suburbs, we fit the bill. So she passed over a lot of churches and decided she wanted to be a part of this faith community. You will be hearing more about Blair this week, and you will also be hearing more about Alvin and their personal stories, because we will share those with you. But today we want to go through the liturgy of welcoming them in officially as new members. So I have some questions for Blair and Alvin. Blair and Alvin, do you desire to affirm your baptism into the faith of Jesus Christ? Do you renounce the powers of evil and desire the freedom of new life in Christ Jesus?
I do.
Do you profess Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior?
I do.
Do you promise by the grace of God to be Christ's disciple, to follow in the way of our Savior, to resist oppression and evil, to show love and justice, and to witness to the work and the word of Jesus Christ as best as you are able?
I promise. With the help of God.
Do you promise, according to the grace given you, to grow in the Christian faith and to be a faithful member of the Church of Jesus Christ, celebrating Christ's presence and furthering Christ's mission in all the world?
I promise, with the help of God.
Do you promise to participate in the life and mission of this family of God's people, sharing regularly in the worship of God and enlisting in the work of this local church as it serves the community and the world?
I promise, with the help of God.
Let us pray. Oh God, you have known each of these individuals. May they give themselves to you to love and serve you faithfully all the days of their life. Amen. Now we have a question for our congregation. We know that you are listening by phone, so we ask that you speak when your turn comes. Let us, the members of United Church of Hyde Park, express our welcome and affirm our mutual ministry in Christ Jesus.
We welcome you with joy in the common life of this church. We promise our continuing friendship and prayers as we share the hopes and labors of the Church of Jesus Christ. By the power of the Holy Spirit, may we continue to grow together in God's knowledge and love and be witnesses of our risen Savior.
Alvin and Blair, it is so good to have you all as members of United. We're excited to have you. We're excited to continue this journey and this work with you, and know that I will be reaching out to the both of you. Thank you so much. So I'm assuming that I'm still on. And it is time for Faith in Action. Each week, we are saying that it is important that we find ways to put our faith into action, or else we could grow in despair. We could feel like all is lost. And so this week I am asking you all, we have a link You can either get that today, or we will also be sending it out Thursday, where you can hit this link to support the HEROES Act. 7 years ago this month, the Supreme Court gutted key provisions of the 1965 Voting Rights Act in its Shelby County versus Holder decision. We are quickly approaching the second election in which we have less voting protections than we did in 1965. That is simply unconscionable. Congress has starved state and local communities of the resources they need to run free, fair, and accessible elections. We have seen widespread polling place closures, long lines with hour-long waits, a backlog of absentee ballot requests, and machine breakdowns in several state primaries. This is a wake-up call for us for the November elections. We're asking you to ask Congress to pass the HEROES Act now to provide state and local officials the critical resources to ensure that we have a safe, fair, and accessible election in November. Please click on that link. If you don't get it today, please click on it Thursday and fill it out so you can alert your elected officials that you support the HEROES Act. Thank you. That is our faith in action for today. Well, you all know all good things must come to an end. And now at this time, we're going to have our closing hymn, and then we'll have a benediction. It's been so good worshiping with you all today. Forth as weeds and seeds, greeting everyone as a part of God's family. Go forth as followers of Christ, serving others that have been thrown aside by the world. Go forth with the gifts of the Holy Spirit, daring to hold on to hope in these times. In Jesus' name, all God's people said,
Amen.
Amen. There is coffee hour right after service today. You can join us by Zoom. For those of you that are out there, you can stay on the line. God bless you and keep you. Amen.